Lee, is your file? Okay. Please let me know, guys, once you can see my notepad.
Yes,
yes, sir.
Okay, great. So any doubts from the earlier class, guys? I think we have covered the GSL parameters, and you might be having some assignments in your hand to complete. Any doubts from them? Okay, I'll assume that there are no doubts so far. But yes, if you have a doubt, please ask me in middle. Now, the topic what we are trying to cover here is the GSL utilities, guys. Now, this is very simple topic, but yeah, in project point of view and in interview point of view, there might be some questions that we face as well. So whenever I use a word utility, guys, it's a pre-coded programs. These are the pre-coded programs with either single or multiple functionalities, available there, okay. Now we can write any logic in COBOL program, guys. We can code any logic, any data logic in COBOL program, okay. That's what we do. But sometimes there are some common logic. There are some common logics which we use, many times. Now, for this kind of situation, guys, the IBM has provided, okay, IBM has provided us with some default or pre-coded programs so that we can directly use it. We can directly use them. Now, in here, guys, there is one specialty of utilities. Okay. For example, if I want to copy a data from a file to another file. Okay, this is what I want to do. A simple logic of data copying. This is the case. If it is done in COBOL program, guys, we're gonna read a record. We're gonna start reading a record, then we're gonna move the record to the output file, and then we're gonna write it. Using these three statements, we can copy the data from one file to another. But can I use this program, first of all, can I use this program to copy any file of any format? Can I use the same logic or same program, not logic, same program for copying any file formats? Or is it only for one particular file format only it will work?
One particular file format only.
Yes. What I'm saying here is, guys, let's say this is the program for copying some claim data. Okay, claim data from one file to another. Now, my question here is, can I use the same program for some policy data or some account details or some sales data as well? Can I use, okay, can I use the same program for copying? Okay, I want to do the same copy only. I want to get the data from one file to another only, but of different file datas. Can I do it by using same program? Can I do it with the same program, guys?
No.
Obviously, no, guys, because the file formats, okay, the record length will be different. We know this, guys. We know this. If the COBOL has a record length of 30, in the GSL also we should have the record length of the file to be 30 only. If there is a mismatch in the length, then we'll be having a file output mismatch case where the files will not be opened with the status code 39. So in here, guys, COBOL can do any logic, but what happens is it is bounded with the record layouts. Same logic cannot be used for different files. It can be used only for that particular file of that particular length of record only. other file formats for the same logic, they have to code different programs. But these are not bounded by the lengths, okay, or file formats or file length, okay. Utilities are very much flexible for any file. You can use a utility for copying a claim file. You can use the same utility program to copy any of these file formats or file data as well. Okay. One point you need to remember from the program point and from a utility point. COBOL program can build any logic. Okay. If you are good in coding, you can build any logic that you need. But the logic is always bounded to a particular file formats only. Whereas the utilities can do a limited functionalities only, okay? Using utilities, you cannot do every data process that came to your business, okay? Using utilities, you can do some functional logics only, but it has a flexibility to apply that logic for any file. That is a primary difference for your knowledge purpose. In interview or anywhere, nobody will ask you. So in the mainframe point of view, in an application, okay, if you go for your application, we see few of them, okay, few of them utilities used highly in the project. One of them are actually IEF BR14. This is one utility. IB Gener, second utility. Then IB Copy, interview purpose. IB Compare, interview purpose. Sort, project and interview purpose. ID Camps, which is for project and interview purpose as well. There are few more utilities which you can ignore, guys, but these are the common utilities that you will be coming across in your work around and in your project in the intro as well. So the first one, guys, okay, first one is IEF BR14. This is a program name, guys. This is a program name. It's already an existing program name. You can use it directly in the production. You can use directly in the test as well. You don't need any compilation. You don't need any code of that. It's already provided load module. You can directly execute in any environment. Now, whenever you come across this utility, guys, this is just like our 3.2 option. Okay, this is like our 3.2 option. Using this utility, we can either create a data set or we can delete a data set. Using IEF BR14, guys, as per the book, okay, again, as per the book, we can create a data set and we can delete a data set. Now, my point here is, okay, in previous case, how did we create our data sets, guys?
How did we create a data set?
In 3.2, allocated data set.
That is one of the options through manual. Okay, this is manual option to create a data set. Now, if I want to do it through job, can I create it through job, guys?
Yeah, new catalog delete.
Through our COBOL program execution time, where we mention this as new catalog and delete kind of situation. But in here, when you're creating a data set with COBOL, you're creating a data file directly. Using IEF BR14, guys, you can create an empty data set. Now, let me help you with a couple of points one more time. Using this utility, you can directly in the JSL can create a data set. You don't need to write a COBOL program. Using this utility, you can create a data set, you can delete a data set. But when you're using this utility, guys, it will help you to create only an empty data set. Now, my question to you all who are already in the mainframe project, why do we need an empty data set? Completely new to the mainframe and you are asking me a question of this one, it's a very valid question. And if you are already in the mainframe project and if you have already used or seen this utility in your project, my question to you all is, why do you want to create an empty data set using this utility in the job?
Anyone?
like few jobs needs to be like needs some files to be created on it.
Yeah, so what is the case? You are saying that you need to create an MD, but why is the question?
During first time job run in production, in such cases
you can do it, right? Can you do it?
Yeah.
So why do you need it?
Maybe to make some job changes.
We can do it in the test environment or development, and but not in the production, right? Production we have to do through the job only.
That's one of the main reasons. Your answer of creating an empty file is right, but you should also have your supporting point also, guys. Okay. There are interior guys who will be not so satisfied with your first level answer because everybody might have already given it. Second point, okay. So in the project, guys, in the project, some says that I want to create, okay, I'll tell you the story, but the story will not come directly here. You need to come to with more knowledge. So in the project, I want to create an file, okay, for a job run, let's say for a job run. If it is test, guys, you can do it by 3.2 and you can create manually. But in the production cases, okay, you are in a situation, there are a couple of situations where you have access to create, then you can still use 3.2. But in the production, you don't have access to create a production data set naming pattern, okay? That cases, in that situation, you need to create a job with IEF VR 14 and create an empty file, okay? Now, this answer is not full-fledged answer, guys, okay? This particular answer is not a full-fledged answer. This needs maybe another one more day of class, okay? Just wait for one more day, okay? Then I can help you with the real situation, okay? Using only this level of understanding, I cannot justifiably give a proper example there. But give me one day, in the next class when we come to the topic, I will help you to understand what we are doing here. But for now, guys, if somebody asked you why you are creating an empty data set, okay, or when you are creating an empty data set, you're going to say that you're going to create an empty data set in production for your job's first run, okay? We're going to create an empty data set. We're going to create an empty data set for our production first run. This is your answer, okay? This is your direct answer, guys. Specifically how this is gonna work, I can tell you in the next class only, too early, okay? Any doubts? Okay, second thing is about deleting a data set, guys, okay? Second thing is to delete a data set. Now, how do you delete a data set, guys?
Using disposition mod delete.
Okay, disposition mod delete. Okay, that is one I can say. Other way, guys, how do you delete your data sets so far till today?
If it is in test, we can give the data set name in 3.4 and just give D in front of it. It will get deleted.
3.4 D as a delete option and enter. This is again a manual way to delete the data set. Guys, here, okay, if you want to delete through a job, okay, if it is through JCL job, you need to use instead of mod, try with old, okay. Mod not gonna lock your data set. Old will lock your data set. Okay, so when you want to update or when you want to delete your data set, the precautionary step is to hold the data set yourself. No other job should use it anywhere in between. So we're gonna use an old option and we can go for delete there. Okay, you know this, guys. Okay, on success and on failure, what does that mean? I will need to delete this data set, even the job is successful, even it is failed. That's what old delete means. Now, if it is manually want to delete, you can go for 3.4, guys. 3.4 and you add D option and delete. Fine. But the question is, why do you want to delete? Why do you want to delete a data set? Why do you want to delete a data set, guys? In production.
Might be we are going to create the same file again for today's job, and yesterday's file we need to delete and exactly. Create a today's file.
Exactly. See, guys, when you are running your job in our training scenario only, when your job is successful, the file has already created. Now, when you are doing testing, what happens? You will be changing the data and running again and again the same job. So each time when you are running the same job, the same file has to be created. But mainframe can allow a data set name only for one time. We cannot have a duplicate data set name. So to avoid the duplicate data set name issue for the second run or later run, later in the sense one or two, third time, fourth time, like that, later run of the same job. Okay, to avoid duplicate data set name error, you'll get this one because you are running the same job which was already ran successfully and created a file. So when you are running again, system will give a JSL error. First it will show JSL error. When you go into the spool and check, that you'll find that it is having a data set already in the same place with the same name. So to avoid that, we're gonna need to delete the data set. Okay, now how to delete? You have two options. You have two options. One is to go and do it 3.4 manually if you are in the test, but in the production you can't do daily yourself. For that, you're gonna need to code a step on the job. You need to code a step in a job to delete the data set. Now these two, okay, whenever you Google it, guys, okay, whenever you Google this utility, you will definitely find these two points, that to create a data set and to delete a data set, that you will definitely find. You'll find a lot of examples programs also there, okay? But don't just remember these two points. Also remember, why is the concept? Why do we need to create empty data set? Why do we need to delete a data set? This particular point you need to know, then only you can identify the use and the purpose, everything. Now, this is what you see in the book. Okay, this is what you see in the book. This is what you do in the project. But there is another concept, guys. Third point, IFBR 14 is used to dummy a job run. Now I'm going to give an example here, guys. In many of my experience, many of my jobs case situations, when they fail, okay, when they fail, many times I can fix and rerun. Okay, I can fix and rerun. That's what we do it. That's what we are supposed to do. But sometimes, guys, sometimes what happens, we are unable to fix it. We cannot unable to fix the issue. Maybe in the time limit what we have, or because of our approach, or we are not able to take the decisions. Such cases, sometimes in the project we are unable to complete the job process. Okay, such cases what we do here is, a job J1 is there, give an example here, step S1 is there, S2 is there, S3 is there, guys. Okay, now S1 is to get the data as input from a shared drive. Okay, drive in the sense some folder, okay, some shared drive using FTP process. then step two is supposed to use it. Step three, you need to use it as the output, okay? Some report or some other file to be created, anything. Now, in some of the situations, what we used to face is the S1 used to fail because the server is down. The server is down, okay? So obviously we are not gonna do anything, guys. It's not our headache. There are supposed to be a team for server maintenance. There are some admins and the team to look into it. Now, sometimes what happens in our project, in our experience, that these servers will not come anywhere sooner now. It may take hours to bring it up. Sometimes it will be a fraction of minutes, guys. It's okay. But we'll take the worst case that the servers are not gonna be up. Now, what's the problem? That's why I don't like. Did he go for mute? No, Abhijit, guy. Mute me, rehna yaar. Main to mere ko disturb ho jayenge. Theek hai. Right. So, S1 failed, guys, and the server is down. It's not gonna be coming up. Now, what you will be doing, guys? How you gonna run the job? How? You're gonna run a job when your server is not up, when your data input is not available. Can I run S2 and S3?
No, we can't run, guys.
We cannot run, as this is the input step. Without the input, the further steps I cannot run. Now, can I keep the job as it is forever till the server comes up?
No, because there may be dependencies.
There might be dependency. In one of the class, I showed you one of the cycle, guys, where I showed you all the colors, blue color, red color kind of boxes, a dependency, right? So if this one is having a dependency, without completing this job, I cannot continue the rest of the process. So sometimes, guys, sometimes you have to close your eyes and move this job completed so that other cycles can at least run with empty data at least, because we cannot keep the cycle holding forever, guys. By the time your morning starts, the business morning starts, your batch cycle should complete. So in some situations only, okay, in some situations you can write like this: job J1 step S1 program equal to IEF VR 14, and then give null statement. Okay, this is your FTP step. Okay, this is your FTP step. This is your S2 and S3. This step is a dummy job. This we call it as a dummy job, which will be always successful. You don't need any DD statements, no step leap, no sysprint, no sysout, nothing, guys. Right? Exit program IBR 14 and just submit it. It will be definitely successful without any other line. Moreover, this is important, the end of the JCL, guys. Till yesterday, when we are trying to understand job, the JCL part, we told job statement, exit statement, DD statements only on a priority basis. But in the production support, guys, in the production support, this // will play a very good role of stopping the job, okay? Stopping the job of not executing the other steps that you don't want. So remember this null statement also. If sometimes you have, okay, in the interview, guys, okay, in the interview, they may say that I have a job 1, 2, 3, 4. Job one is come, step one is 1, 2, 3, 4 is there. Step one and two completed. I just want to run only step three. I would like to run only step three. I don't want to run step four below it. Such kind of questions will come where you don't have a statement. You have a trick to play. So remember these kind of examples, guys. Okay, in the project, in your experience, you may already use it, or you will be gonna use it mandatorily. Okay, this is one point of example. Remember, in a projection scenario. Second case I have. Same job J1. What are the job I have written? I no longer need it. To run. Okay. I no longer need it to run, guys. How do I do it? are the options we have?
Remove it from the schedule and update the dependencies of other jobs.
If you are not in the scheduler, okay, if your job is not in the scheduler, guys, your job will not run. Okay, but sometimes what happens, the complexity will be there with the other applications or other jobs to be dependent on that one. Okay, so sometimes what we do here is option two, again the same thing, again the same solution, guys, nothing there. Okay, the job will be there, but in the job you'll be having only single step. This is also a simple way of no longer absoluting a job. Okay, in the project sometimes you'll come to a job which is no longer used by anyone, but removing from a scheduler, changing the dependencies and everything may cause another issue or maybe some little bit complex with the dependencies. Such cases alone, you can dummy a job like this, guys. Okay, your job should exist, but it should not fail for any reason. So you cannot submit a job without any single step, guys. Okay, you cannot submit a job without a step, but I would like to run a job with a dummy reason. So such cases, this IBR 14 is very much used, guys. Okay, if you observe in these two examples, okay, where I'm trying to dummy this case or dummy this case, come under these two points. It will never come in that point, guys. Okay, remember this one, to dummy a job. This you can remember. If it comes in your project, that's good for our training. If it doesn't come to the project, that's also good. You are your experience point. So any doubts in this one?
Yes, Anil, I have a doubt. In the first example that you have shown, right? Like where the server is down. So in that example, when the server is down and the job is not running, we will get some kind of alert, like it will be different in different projects. So once we got that alert, we have to override like we have to override the job with this step, and then we have to run.
Yes, right?
This is something we need to code manually at that time. And
yes. It's a situation. Okay. This is your production job. This is what you are doing. So obviously you have to edit, right?
Okay. And one more thing. In this case, when this job has some other dependencies, to avoid those jobs being on hold only, we are doing this, right? But those jobs are actually depending on the output of this job, right? When we are running this job with just...
empty run. That's what's happening here.
Okay.
We are forced to complete the cycles because there might be some other files which have a data. This is one of the file with the data, right?
Yeah, so the dependent jobs also will run with the empty.
Not always like that, okay? Your situation is on a single line of input, but our project situations, how will be there? This is one of the input only, not the only input. Okay, this is one of the inputs. So let me show you that example also. You already seen it, just to your reminding point. Your situations, okay, you need to face your situations. When you are having a time for taking decision, that's fine. When there are no times, you'll be facing a lot of cases here. Now, assume that these are the four jobs which are getting inputs. Okay, A, B, C, D are getting the inputs. This one is having issue. This one is having issue. What shall you do? Let's wait or dummy it. You got my point?
Yeah.
You may say that you are running empty. No, we are not running empty there. This is one of the input. We have other inputs to process. Your job is there, right? If you are in a situation, this is your situation, what you will do? Will you wait, make it to wait forever till the server comes and all this to be waited? Because without this, this will wait. Without this, this will wait. And other things which are down also, they'll be waiting, right? Now you tell me, if you are in this situation, what you're going to take? Option one, you have to wait. That's the only option you have, to wait for the server to come up, because we cannot provide the inputs manually anyway. Option two, what you will do, let this particular run with run empty file. Let it go with empty today. We're going to process all the records tomorrow. You got it?
Yeah.
Depends on your situation, okay? Let's assume that you are in a situation that there is no other way, you cannot run without that file. Then obviously you have to wait for it, right? You got it? If you say that my file is mandatory, without that I cannot run, then there is no way that you will be doing a dummy case. You'll be just waiting there. But the situation what I explained here is to move along. You can't wait there because of there are other processes which to critical which has to run complete as well along with this dependency. So what is your situation? What's your solution will change? Okay. When you are in the same situation like me, when your request has come to dummy a job, then this is the solution you should try. You got it?
Yes, Anil.
Yes, Anil. One point to discuss here. In this case, suppose we are getting the same error for the second time. To get the permanent solution, can we add one more step below the S1? As I'll be giving condition that if S1 failed, then we can use the step for IVR14 with the same logic.
It depends your situation of abend. When it abends, you want to run a step, you can run, but your job will be in abend state and other jobs will be in waiting state only, right? Your point is when a job abends, you want to run IVR14. No, that is not the point here. When a job abends, your cycle will wait.
No, I'm talking about the step. When step got a problem, like we are not getting file from shared drive,
right,
then only our second step will execute. In that second step, I'm going to give IVR14.
But what is the use of that?
Okay.
Your job is still in abend state, right?
Yes, right.
So.
Okay, got it. Okay.
Yeah. Right. Any other doubt, guys? Come on, guys. You are supposed to keep your head in this particular game. I told you the JSL what you learned in the earlier classes are completely developer level. The JSL that you're going to learn is completely on the production side. So your examples, your thinking should be in a situation where you are falling into a puzzle and you want to come out of that puzzle solutions. So these are the examples that will come into picture, guys. Now, the second one what we have is IBGener.